This week on Maker Update, a peripheral with all the keys, a tuba with all the wubs, a classic click wheel, and a guidebook to Huaqiangbei. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you up to date on all the cool things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner, and I hope you're all doing great and you've got a cool project to keep you going through these cold and dark winter months. If you don't, well then look on, dear friends, because we've got a great show for you. So let's check out the project of the week. We've seen a few of Salim Benbouziyane's custom interface devices before, but this modular macro keyboard system that he's created in his latest video is on a whole nother level. You probably have seen all manner of Kickstarters and commercial projects that do something similar to what this project does. Only in Salim's video, you get to see what goes into every aspect of the design of a device like this. Design constraints, PCB design, interfaces, circuits, the whole lot. Those design constraints are what I'd like to highlight first. This is a super important step in any big project. It helps you define the problem you're actually trying to solve. It'll help you keep your most important goals in mind the whole way through, and it'll also keep you from getting lost in adding features that don't help you. In this case, he wanted the macro pad system to conform to a grid layout, with the main panel representing 2x2 squares. The components will snap together using magnets and communicate using a series of pogo pins. Each setup will communicate power and ground, two more pins for I2C, and an additional pin for interrupts. Of course, you can get pogo pin magnet connectors in a variety of configurations as a commercial option. But pricing drove Salim to make his own DIY solution, with a small vertically oriented PCB and soldered on pins. In his original design spec, he created 5 different boards: a main hub with 12 keys and 2 rotary encoders, one with 4 encoders, one with 2 slide potentiometers, another with 3 keys and a rotary encoder, and a last one with a big CNC encoder and 4 keys. I could keep going on about all the details in this project, but I do want to shout out the colored 3D printable resin he used for the keycaps. This is a system by Hey Gears. They're a sponsor for his video, but they give you a color swatch and mixing ratios to achieve a variety of specific colors for your print. To my eyes, Salim's videos are almost like watching a hardware design studio at work, except he shares his entire process. There's a full GitHub repo for the project and build instructions on Instructables. More projects. Through TikTok, I learned about SousaFX by John Bailey's. This is a combination of a microphone and a mute that turns your bass brass into an electronic instrument with all the wubs. The microphone is plugged into a USB audio interface that talks to the Ableton Live DAW. But the real secret sauce here is his own custom plugin that takes inputs from a video game controller to modulate the sound for playback. That could be enough, but it just isn't. Since a sousaphone has such a large and visually striking bell, it only makes sense to make it part of the show, right? SousaFX also ties into SousaVFX, which drives an LED matrix that can be installed in the instrument, creating a visual display as unique as the sound. From the Ruiz brothers, we have this 3D printed LED fidget toy in game. One of the first things that caught my eye about this one was the design. From the deep organic shape of the outer body, with the easily grippable sides and the deep recess for the scroll wheel. But the real talking point here is the Anno navigation wheel. Come for the rotary encoder, but stay for the D-pad at the edges. This interface does it all. Plus, there's a custom Adafruit PCB to make it easy to use. It's a great project and a super cool showcase for this hardware. From Greg Zumwalt, we have a new kinetic design for a Geneva clock. I'd previously seen this sort of clock design called a wandering hour clock, but in this version, calling it a Geneva clock makes sense since it makes use of the Geneva mechanism, this fascinating slot and cam design for interval rotations. It manually connects to NTP servers to get the right time and then happily goes about its business, telling the time in its own unique way. Time for some tips and tools. If you want to build electronics on a product scale, you're probably going to Shenzhen. The trouble with Shenzhen is if you're not a local, you're going to be lost here. Which is why Bunnie Huang teamed up with Naomi Wu to produce this guidebook, the new essential guide to electronics in Shenzhen. This is intended to be your handy guidebook, written by a native, to the confusing but outstanding markets of Huaqiangbei. A few weeks ago, we had Adam Savage talking about shop redesigns. And now he's ready to show off how he's redesigned his own workspace. The moral of this story is that upending your shop is hard. We're all creatures of comfortable habit. But when Adam adopted a key piece of furniture from the old ILM model shop, something had to give. And it gave way to his new favorite shop layout. Sometimes you need a little outside chaos to bring in your new favorite thing. Over on the Core 77 blog, I came across this post about tool storage used by firefighters. Firefighters have some pretty unique tool storage needs. They need to be secure and not rattle around or move while the vehicle's in motion. But they also need to be easy to retrieve, especially by a person wearing heavy gloves. The primary version of these is a product called Tool Lock, which uses a hardened cradle and a flexible retaining strap. Maybe not what you need for your own tool wall most of the time, but you might have a specific need, or might pick up a few design ideas from this one. And from the latest of Gareth's Tips, Tools, and Shoptails newsletter, we have a great roundup of tips here. How to assemble the best toolkit, how to organize your tools using scraps of Romex electrical wire, and the best way to keep your shop comfortably warm with a space heater without setting it on fire. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we have the latest video from the Byte-Sized Engineer. And it's all about getting more out of the GPIO from your microcontroller. If you're building a project and you realize your controller doesn't have enough GPIO, there's still a path forward. GPIO multiplexing. I've seen this technique done before using a dedicated IC, but this is the first time I've seen it just using clever circuit design. His initial demo is for output using RGB LEDs, but then moves on to key matrices that reduce the number of inputs needed to interface with them. It's a great learning tip. Check it out. All right, and that is gonna do it for this week's show. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you had a great time nerding out with me over all these fantastic projects. And remember, you can learn so much more about each of them by checking out the show notes. While you're there, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next show. As always, great big thanks to DigiKey for making this whole show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.